This video is brought to you by Captivating History. In the 8th century BC, a kingdom from northern Africa invaded Egypt and extended as far as the modern-day Middle East. Identified by the Egyptians as Kush, it evolved from a local settlement named Kerma into one of the most fascinating empires in African history. They reached their zenith after the fall of the New Kingdom of Egypt. Often overlooked by modern historians, wrongly so, the Kushites married the artistic fervor of the Egyptians with the vibrancy of African traditions. Like a breath of fresh air, they ushered in an age of Egyptian Renaissance and provided some of the most significant contributions to both African and Egyptian cultures. But who were the Kushites, and where did they come from? The Kushites had their stronghold in modern-day Sudan in the Valley of the Nile. But to understand where they came from, one has to go way back. Let's turn the clock back to 5000 BC. Due to its proximity to the Nile, the land of northern Africa was quite favorable to agriculture. The people lived in small, independent, and mobile communities. Archaeological findings estimate that these groups were engaged in fishing, hunting, farming, and livestock. Over the next few centuries, temperatures started dropping in the entire region. The land became riper, inviting more people into the hospitable Nile Valley. The Egyptians used to call the Nile the source of life, and it's not hard to see why. The North African region of Nubia starts with the formation of Nile proper and extends toward the Mediterranean, and was an extensive source of raw materials. As climate conditions turned favorable by the year, populations started to grow. Around 3000 BC, the region began to give shape to an urban settlement called Kerma, one of the first ones in sub-Saharan Africa. Within the next 500 years, it developed into a thriving urban culture, the home of the Kushites. Connected by the Nile, the Egyptians and the Kushites have been in contact since the early dynastic period, circa 3100 to 2686 BC. But it was not until the establishment of Kerma that the relationship intensified, at times complementary, at times hostile and competitive. The kingdoms had back-and-forth invasions. When cooler heads prevailed and amicable terms were agreed upon, commerce flourished. Trade was conducted mainly through land, as were invasions. Navigation across the Nile was near impossible, save for a high tide. Speaking of trade, the North African region occupied one of the most opportune geographical locations on the planet, especially for Kush, which was part of some of the most critical trans-African routes. The East and the West came head-to-head at the Red Sea, whereas the South and the North came together against the Mediterranean. So, the Kush had access to the eastern routes toward India and China, and those for heading inland into southern Africa. And if that wasn't enough, they also had access to the Nile Delta and the Mediterranean Sea. Egypt's internal strife was escalating for a while before the tribes of Thebes and Hyksos finally went to war around 1570 BC, giving the Kush free reign of the land. The population of Kerma had already reached about 10,000 people by 1700 BC, so they decided to extend their influence and established a new city towards the south. The city, called Napata, was home to Jebel Barkal, a sacred mountain that held significant religious and navigational value to the Kush. While Egypt was involved in internal squabbles, Napata thrived, eventually evolving from a mere chiefdom into a full-fledged empire. The people of Kush increased in wealth and influence. The morale boost from Jebel Barkal and the economic resourcefulness acted as catalysts to the already steady ascent. By 1600 BC, the Kushites were taking over most of the trade routes in the region, which did not sit well with the Egyptians. But as annoyed as they were, the Egyptians had their own problems to deal with. In the period of the New Kingdom, 1567 to 1085 BC, Egypt established control of Nubia and invaded Palestinian and Syrian provinces, becoming one of the largest empires of ancient times. But by the end of the era, outside forces had started to gain, and Egypt had lost considerable ground. The civil wars and tribal disputes between kings were taking their inevitable toll as well. The Palestinian and Syrian land was lost, and Egypt was disintegrating bit by bit. Eventually, the Libyans invaded and took control of Egypt. At the time, King Kashta ruled the land of Kush. He decided to finally focus his people's attention inwards and become the first monarch of the newly established Kingdom of Kush. An influential man with considerable power, he invaded Egypt and was able to conquer Thebes. His goals were not facetious or bound by boastful glory, but instead united by a singular purpose. The religious tenets of both Egyptians and Kushites were virtually identical. Kashta wanted to appeal to religious sentiment to unify the region. Let's delve into the cultural overlaps between the Egyptians and the Kushites for a moment. Since these cultures have been interacting with each other for multiple centuries, they had developed an interesting rapport that extended beyond social mannerisms and into artistic and cultural trends. The Egyptian rule during the age of the New Kingdom had left an impact on the Kushites. Both cultures engaged in mutual exchange. There have been some accusations of the Kushites stealing their cultural legacy from the Egyptians. While it is true that the Kushites learned a lot from the Egyptians, they infused everything with an overwhelming vivacity of the African spirit. From visual arts to craftsmanship, the Kushites knew how to represent themselves. You have probably come across Egyptian hieroglyphics. The Kushites used hieroglyphics as well, although they were slightly different. The Egyptians also influenced the clothing and rituals of the Kushites. Cultural exchange is a natural phenomenon that occurs whenever two civilizations or even two tribes come together. You can see this exchange everywhere, from Picasso's inception of Cubism to European fascination with Orientalism. In the case of Egypt and the Kingdom of Kush, you can see it most clearly in the pyramids. Sudan contains almost 1,000 pyramids, out of which about 300 are structurally intact. Its modern-day neighbor, Egypt, known for its mysterious artifacts, has about 100. While the Egyptian pyramids are harmonious and grandiose, the pyramids in Sudan are steep, towering, and imposing. But to think that the Kushites inherited everything from their Egyptian contemporaries would be a step too far. The Kushites were great artisans. They were masters at the art of pottery. Some experts think that they were among the first Africans who learned how to enamel pottery. Similarly, the Kushites liked creating large structures called defufas. These defufas are amongst the first examples of brick used in Nile Valley civilizations. If anything, their artistic aspirations increased tenfold once Pianki, also known as Pie, Kashta's successor, came into power and continued his campaign against Libyan rule over Egypt. As the Kingdom of Kush slowly absorbed Egypt, the Egyptian masses welcomed the change in power. After a successful conquest, Pianki died, leaving the throne to Shabaka. In the 8th century BC, Shabaka managed to successfully establish and assert his dynasty. The 25th dynasty of Egypt, also known as the Nubian dynasty, or the Kushite Empire, brought an influx of inspired creativity. Extensive care and support were levied to the arts and architecture. After Shabaka's death, Shibitku rose to power. Shibitku bore his share of scuffles with the Assyrians from the east, but managed to fend them off. Then came Taharqa, the most important figure of the Nubian dynasty, who introduced writing into his courts. He also emphasized architecture, restoring old Egyptian temples and ordering the creation of new ones. His love for grandeur is visible in monuments throughout Egypt and across the Nile, including temples, baths, palaces, and most importantly, pyramids. After being restricted to Egypt by the Assyrians, he sharpened his focus on his building projects. One major example of this tunnel vision is the Temple of Karnak. A magnificent marvel of ancient Egyptian architecture, the temple is thought to have been a place of ritual and worship where the sun god interacted and talked to the individuals. After Taharqa's death, Tentamani came into power and tried to assert his dominance in the region by taking on the Assyrians, who did not take kindly to the notion. Their retort came in the form of plundering and looting Thebes. Thebes lay in a heap of ashes with no hope of revival. The Kushites had no choice but to retreat inwards. They never returned to Egypt again. Around 591 BC, they decided to settle in Miro, in northern Sudan. Miro was rich in iron, ivory, gold, and other natural resources. They established stable trade routes to the Red Sea and the rest of Africa. Before long, the city became an esteemed commercial center. During this time, the Meroitic writing system took off, not just in courts, but also in the streets. There is overwhelming evidence that this hieroglyphic script became the general form of writing in the region. In 22 BC, the Kushites agreed to a truce with the emerging superpower of the time, the Roman Empire. Afterward, the land seemed to become a diasporic melting pot with tribal groups and mercenaries. In the 4th century AD, nomads by the name of Noba conquered the city, giving the name Nubia to the region. With his glory faltered, shrines abandoned, and ambitions trampled, the golden age of Kush was no more. Shortly afterward, the kingdom of Aksum invaded the city. By the 6th century, the kingdom of Kush had been dissolved, and Miro was abandoned, putting an end to a fascinating chapter in the history of Northern Africa. A far more thorough treatise is available if you'd like to learn more about the Kingdom of Kush. Check out our book, The Kingdom of Kush, a captivating guide to an ancient African kingdom in Nubia that once ruled Egypt. It's available as an ebook, paperback, and audiobook. Also, grab your free Mythology Bundle ebook for free while they're still available. All links are in the description. If you enjoyed the video, please hit the like button and subscribe for more videos like this.